blood is precious, the ransom fee. Its value priceless, its healing free. His wisdom new, just what I need. Praise God, his blood now has rescued me.
Let's pray. Father, we're so very glad to be able to spend this time with you in this first day of the week, a day in which most of the world is focused on your resurrection, at a time when often they are not thinking about spiritual things at all. Let us use this day to reach out to others, to let them know that Christ has indeed been raised, that mankind does have hope, and that we no longer need to live in sin, die in sin, because your Son, Jesus, has taken away the scourge of sin from us. We are no longer under the curse of that because he has taken that upon himself. And as we sing songs about the resurrection, we know, Lord, that these are based in Scripture to help us understand better, to help our hearts truly have the joy that we should have at this time of resurrection. And we know, Lord, that your Son has done this for us. He's accomplished it. It is finished. And we just need to obey it and live faithfully before you. Thank you, Lord, for your love. In Jesus we pray. Amen. The resurrection. The resurrection is, of course, the very focal point of what we as Christians are all about. Every first day of the week, we come together to worship God because that was the day in which he was raised from the dead. We celebrate the Lord's Supper, and when we do so on the first day of every week, we celebrate his death until he comes again. We talk about the resurrection and knowing that that Jesus has conquered death, that we no longer have to be dead in our sins, but we have hope that mankind has never had before. This really is the core of Christianity right here in the passage that was just read. He has risen, he is not here. That's something that we need to take to heart, because we can talk about, you know, all kinds of wonderful things about how it is we ought to live and what we ought to believe and what the truth is about this subject or that subject. I've always wondered, what about the dinosaurs? You know, that's something, and it seems like the people out in the world want to talk about all kinds of things, but we need to focus them in on what is essential, what is of first importance. And so, I would like to take a look at 8 verses in Mark chapter 16 of the resurrection and what happened. We're going to do that from the introduction through the first 3 points, 2 verses each, but we're going to combine it with the verses of the song, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. I think a study of the song and what goes on in that song is very important for us to understand. Now, something about songs. Songs are not inspired, not like Scripture is inspired. There can be inspired things within those songs. I think we can see a lot of doctrine that comes straight from Scripture in the songs that we sing, and it's singing as part of our worship. And so I think it's good sometimes to take a look at some of our songs and say, where in Scripture does this idea, this theme come from? So it's built a little bit differently than our normal sermons are built, in which we start with a passage, and from that passage we're trying to explore what God has to say to us. In this case, we take a song and we say, what are the verses singing about, and are they in Scripture? Where are they in Scripture? And what is God really trying to get us to understand through those Scriptures that help build those songs and really speak to our heart and help us out here a little bit? So, what is going on here? Did I hit something here on my clicker while I was talking? Boy. Okay, this may be a fun lesson. Okay, we're starting over. Okay, here we go. He is risen. Yep, he is not here. Okay, so here's the first couple of verses of the passage we're going to focus in on today. The first eight verses of the resurrection story from the book of Mark. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And so the very first couple of lines of the first stanza of this song say, Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Son of man and angels say, hallelujah. And so where do we get this kind of thing from? Christ the Lord is risen today. And so we see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 20. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. It's a fact that Paul is saying here to the church in Corinth that indeed God has been raised. And this is the focal point, as I said, of all of our Christian understanding and doctrine. We also see in Luke chapter 2, the beginning of this story. It's not about resurrection, but the angels speaking to the shepherds call it good news of great joy. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And suddenly there was the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is blessed. It was good news at the time of Jesus' birth when the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. It was good news of great joy then. He needed to be made like us in every way in order to go to the cross and then to be raised to give us that hope. So how much more is the good news of great joy at the time that he is born, the victory that we have in him? The second part of that first stanza says, raise your joys and triumph high. Hallelujah. Sing ye heavens, thou earth, reply. What is the earth replying in this particular instance? We can go back to 1 Corinthians 15. It says, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Raise your triumphs high. And the world, the earth, in reply says this, for the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. And so all the earth is waiting, cursed, as we see in Genesis chapter 3 and onward, longing for the sons of God to be revealed. And so we can see the earth's reply to this good news of great joy. What a wonderful thing it is. And today we're going to be talking about the resurrection through the song, Christ the Lord is risen today. Love's redeeming work is done. Lo, our sun's eclipse is o'er. In verses 3 and 4 of our study here in the book of Mark about the resurrection, it says, and they were saying to one another, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. The second stanza of that song says, love's redeeming work is done. Hallelujah. Fought the fight, the battle won. Hallelujah. And so love's redeeming work is done. Where do we get that from? Galatians chapter 3. We can see that we were under a curse because we had all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We were separated from God by our sins. And we see that Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. He's cursed for us, and that's where, on the cross, he fought our battle. that we sing about in that second stanza in the first part. Hebrews chapter 12 talks about this battle that he fought. And how did he get through that battle? When you're in the midst of a struggle, when you're in the midst of a battle, you don't focus on what's going on at that time. You focus on the goal ahead. And that's exactly what Jesus did as he fought that battle for us on our behalf. Let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And there it was, as he was on that cross, when the battle was fought, the battle was won, he was able to say, "It is finished," and he yielded up his spirit. And because of that, we are able to draw near. The last couple parts of that second stanza says, "Lo, our sun's eclipse is o'er." Hallelujah. "Lo, he sets in blood no more." Well, we know that our eclipse is speaking about death. This is a figurative way of speaking about death. Our sun's eclipse. We understand that when the sun goes down, it's dark. It's the end of our day. It's the end of our life. We had nothing to look forward to but death, because we had all earned death by our sins. Romans chapter 6 tells us that, "For the wages of sin is death." And if it ended there, what a sad story that would be for us. But it continues. It gives us hope in the second part of that verse. "But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord," that came through the resurrection. Life came to us because of what Jesus did upon that cross and shedding his blood. Because he did fight that battle, because he did do the work of salvation there on the cross for us, we are able to draw near to God through what Jesus accomplished there. "Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith." Vain the stone, the watch, the seal. Death in vain forbids his rise. The verses 5 and 6 of Mark 16 says, "And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, 'Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him.'" And so we have the third stanza, the first half of that, saying, "Vain the stone, the watch, the seal. Hallelujah, Christ hath burst the gates of hell." It's not like they didn't try, though. They tried in every earthly way possible to keep this movement of Christianity from happening. The threat of his resurrection from the dead, the only way they could see it happening was the disciples coming in the dead of night, somehow overpowering these Roman soldiers, and stealing the body away in the night. How could that be possible? Vain the stone, the watch, the seal. The only thing they couldn't withstand was God's strength. And certainly that seemed to happen there. Matthew 28 adds this to the resurrection story. It says, "The angel's appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow, and for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men." I like to think of those as big, burly guards, these Roman soldiers. They had one job, and boy, this job seemed like an easy job to them, because they just had to sit at the tomb of a dead man. There was a wax seal that was keeping the stone there in place, and who might come against them? Not some big enemy force trained in battle, but some fishermen, a tax collector. I mean, who was really going to come and try to overpower them in the middle of the night? This was an easy job. This was some easy money that they could make. And so they were there, but what they didn't count on was God's power from within. that Jesus would be raised from the dead. All earthly might was against them. We were told that the gates of hell would not prevail against the kingdom of God. We found that out in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18. And so we see in 1 Peter 3, it says, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah." The gates of hell could not prevail. Jesus has opened them, burst them open. And we see that all those who were faithful to God in the Old Testament time, that the blood of the cross stretched in both directions, Romans chapter 3, 21 to 26, and we can see that Jesus has indeed done it. He is finished. The second part of that third stanza says, "Death in vain forbids his rise." Death had always been in charge. Death had been mankind's worst enemy since the beginning of time. There was no way that any of us could ever keep from experiencing that second death and being separated from God because we had sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's no way we could go back to be with Him. And we're told in 1 Corinthians 11, 26 that the last enemy to be conquered is death itself. Christ hath opened paradise. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, we see that Jesus has tasted death for us all. But we see him for a little while who was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. Now that he has tasted it, we don't need to get a mouthful of it at all. We have a way in which we can avoid having to put that into our mouth altogether because Jesus has done it. Jesus has opened paradise. We might think of the repentant thief, the one who was beside Jesus, not the one who continued to revile Jesus, but the other one who realized his situation, realized that they were deserving of their crimes, but Jesus had done nothing, that he was innocent. And in Luke chapter 23, 42 and 43, and he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus is that judge, he and he alone, as to who will go to heaven. Lives again our glorious King. Once he died, our souls to save. The last couple of verses of Matthew 16, our passage here this morning, or this evening. "But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee." I don't know if it ever struck you as being a little strange, but the angel says, "Go tell his followers and Peter." Why is Peter's name mentioned separately?
Because he denied Jesus.
He denied Jesus. We see that. He denied Jesus, and we see that he realized, because when the cock crowed, he looked straight at Jesus, and I believe it's Luke's account, says that Jesus looks right at him, and Peter goes out and weeps. And so Peter probably doesn't count himself among those followers anymore because of what he had done to Jesus. Maybe we see ourselves at times when we have sinned and fallen short, and we recognize how we've separated ourselves from God, and we think, there's no way that there could be any kind of forgiveness, no kind of grace that could be left for me. And here, at the time of the resurrection, the angel is saying to these women here, "Go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." Peter is included. And we know from John's account that Jesus will find a way to bring Peter back into the fold. "And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." And so our fourth stanza of the song here, we can see in the first half, lives again our glorious King, hallelujah. "Where, O death, is now thy sting, hallelujah." I've always liked that line, where, O death, is now thy sting, because it's like, in your face, death, we have conquered death through Jesus. He has done it for all of us so that we no longer have to taste that death anymore. And so we can see that Jesus is that resurrection and the life. He said this to Martha, the older sister, after Lazarus had passed away, and he's on his way to the house and to the tomb where Lazarus would be, and he would raise Lazarus from the dead. And Jesus said to her, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? We need to believe this. We need to obey that gospel in order to avoid that death. Jesus is our resurrection and our life. Why? Because he's conquered death. 1 Corinthians 15, when the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The last part of that fourth stanza says, once he died, our souls to save. Hallelujah. Where's thy victory, boasting grave? Hallelujah. Jesus only needed to go to the cross once. Once offered as a sacrifice for all time, for all mankind, being that perfect sacrifice, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Once he died, our souls to save. Hallelujah. Where's thy victory, boasting grave? He is our high priest. Hebrews chapter 7 says, consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. He always lives to intercede. And so for those who are in Christ, who obey that gospel, come into his death, and so therefore his resurrection, we have overcome the world. And this is how we end that song with this doctrine, for everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? And so I think a fitting closing is also the invitational song, that if we stand during this closing, if we stand while we sing this, we can also be able to understand the resurrection. And I don't have a book in front of me. I'm hoping they put the song up. But Christ the Lord is risen today. Now that we've looked through the doctrine of some of the verses there, perhaps this will enhance our singing of this song as we are able to know better the words and what's behind those words as we go through this song. Do I just need to grab a book? I think it's 97 in your books, if you'd like to turn there.
All the grace I see.